Many young people write to me for advice about singing Wagner. Some of them ask me if I will give them lessons. Others want to know how they can make a start. As if it were possible to start one's career with Wagnerian roles instead of ending with them. Now, I'm not a teacher, and I never wanted to be. I wasn't taught to explain, only to sing. But perhaps I can still give good advice about many matters connected with the singing of Wagner roles. And my first piece of advice to young and immature singers can be put into three words. Leave Wagner alone. Because he calls for powers which can only develop after many years of singing. I was already 34 years old and had been singing regularly for about 15 years before I attempted my first Wagnerian role, Elsa in Lohengrin. That is one of Wagner's lighter roles, but even so, it calls for great vocal experience. For the real heavy parts, like Isolde and Brunhilde, you need even more. A perfectly placed voice, absolute control of the breath, and immense staying power. Many a promising beginner has come to grief for lack of these qualities. I had three teachers, the first when I was 16. The age when some of these youngsters who write to me would like to start singing is older. And they all taught me along the same lines. By that, I mean that I never had to go to a new teacher because I was dissatisfied with the one before. They simply took over from one another in a process of natural development. Therefore, I never had any real singing difficulties. I never had to unlearn anything. My voice simply grew. And it is this word, grow, which is most important of all. For the singer who wants to sing Wagner must be something like a weightlifter, building his muscles by slow degrees, adding gradually to the weights he lifts until he's able to attempt the very heaviest. Isolde and Brunhilde are the heaviest roles a singer can ever be called upon to sing. And if you ever wish to sing them, you must be prepared for many years of steady growing before you make the attempt. English and American audiences associate me almost entirely with Wagner, but I sang Nedda, Mimi, Tosca, Aida, Desdemona, Marguerite, Michaela, and many other roles all before I ever sang a note of Wagner. I also sang in many operettas, such as The Dollar Princess, Gypsy Love, and Fledermaus. And these helped me to develop my acting and gave me a thorough understanding of stage business, a very necessary preparation for the heavier and more exacting work that was to come. And it was only after all this experience that I felt ready to sing Elsa, and later Isolde, my second Wagnerian role, and finally Brunhilde. People sometimes ask how one memorizes such long parts as Isolde and Brunhilde. Speaking for myself, I start by singing the part over at the piano, gradually forming my own ideas of what it is all about. Perhaps because my background was a very musical one, my father and mother were both professional musicians, it is the music which first fixes itself in my memory. Next come the words, which require really hard work, especially as Wagner is nearly always sung in the original German, which is not my native language. Even now, I sometimes make mistakes in the German words. Having got a pretty good idea of the words and music, I am now ready to work with a coach. This time, it is he who sits at the piano and plays, while I stand and try to sing from memory. I give myself entirely into his professional hands, resting upon his knowledge and experience, until at last, after many months of hard work, I am ready for stage rehearsals with the producer and conductor. And so at last the curtain rises on the Isolde or Brunhilde I've been striving to create. In connection with this, I might mention that I always sing with full voice at rehearsals, finding that this builds up my endurance, which is very necessary for long and heavy performances. But even now, the work of learning does not cease. The interpretation of masterworks like those of Wagner, Goethe, and Shakespeare is a process of never-ending development, Always the role is beyond one's complete grasp. It is only possible to come a little nearer to it with each performance, but never to reach it. Always there are flashes of new inspiration, fresh subtleties, deeper meanings. That is what makes the work so endlessly absorbing. That is why one can never grow weary of it. The fact that singers have to perform the same works on different stages, in different costumes and settings, with different colleagues and under different conductors all over the world, also presents many problems. But the disadvantages involved are more than outweighed by the stimulus of meeting new audiences and of working in new surroundings. All my three teachers taught me to relax, always to try and keep calm. And I think I must be successful in this. For even if I sometimes feel very nervous, apparently I don't show it. For my colleagues nearly always come to me for confidence and assurance. I'm usually so relaxed before I go onto the stage or concert platform that I find myself constantly yawning. And yawning is the most relaxed position of the throat and neck. I was taught from the very beginning always to sing with words, even in my exercises. That is to say, I was taught from the very beginning that the words and their meanings must be inseparable from the music. This is especially important in Wagner, which consists so much of long narrative passages where the singer is telling what has happened before in the story. When I had my audition at Bayreuth in 1932, I was told that I should have to improve my German diction. This Wagnerian diction consists in the strong explosion of the consonants, especially the end ones. I'm very shy about practicing, especially if I think anyone is listening. Once on the way to Australia, where I was to give some concerts, I was so conscious of the passengers in the cabins on either side of me that I practiced with my head out of the porthole, hoping that the sound of the sea would drown me. I practice very little before a performance, but I do always sing a certain phrase which I find very helpful. It is a beautiful passage from Die Walküre, in which Brynhilde warns Siegmund he is to die. I was always taught that if the low voice is rightly placed, then the high voice will be in position too. And this is a phrase I use as my own little test piece.
Nur tut geweihten, tut geweihten, taugt mein Anblick, wir mich erschaut, dir scheidet vom
a record of the scene in which this passage comes, with Seth Swanholm singing Siegmund.
Thank you.
I expect you would like to hear at least one story about Brunhilde's horse, Grane. Here is mine. One day, the producer at the Metropolitan Opera House in New York told me I couldn't have my usual horse because the owner had gone bankrupt and the brokers had locked it up. What? I said. Not even a horse in the last act? Oh, my. What shall I do? Well, I suppose I looked so disappointed that the stage manager said that he would do his best to find one. When I was on the stage ready to sing the final scene, I still had no idea if he had succeeded. Then, right on his cue, on walked the most beautiful horse I've ever seen, a policeman's horse, so tall that I could hardly get my arm over his neck. When I tell you that his name was Nelson, you will not be surprised to know that he behaved beautifully, just as if he had been performing in Grand Opera for many years. Certainly he deserved the lumps of sugar I gave him after the performance. Wagner is not the whole of my artistic life. I also do many recitals because I find the lovely songs of Schubert, Brahms, Strauss, and Grieg are an excellent counterbalance to my heavier work in opera. It is good for a singer who has to use powerful tones on the stage to scale her voice down to the intimacy of lieder singing. In this record of the end of Isolde's narration, my voice is at full power. As a contrast, here is my recording of the Forelle by Schubert.
Thank you.
I've often sung into a microphone, of course, but talking into one has been quite a new experience for me, and I assure you, a very happy one.